Grace and peace to you, and welcome on this feast day of Christ the King. It is the last Sunday of the church year, and we like to celebrate last Sunday. So today we focus on Christ as the one who is anointed by God to be ruler of all creation. Today we also have our small bluegrass band here. Thank you all for coming and playing today. They played on Thanksgiving Eve. If you missed that, you get your chance here. And today we also have Brother John, our seminary student, who's going to be preaching for us on the last Sunday of the year. So thank you, John, for stepping up and doing that. All of the music for today is printed in the bulletin. I know there are lots of hymns we're going to sing that you may never have sung before, but you know, you're Lutheran to the core, so don't hesitate to just sing out and harmonize if you want to. We can, you know, sound like Mennonites. They always sound beautiful. So, but you really just have a good time singing this wonderful music. We're going to begin with a little prelude for you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the aid of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of the Holy Spirit that, attentive to your word, we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you to eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand for the entrance hymn. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Praise to you, O Lord our God, King of the universe,
who creates and sustains and brings to fulfillment.
Praise to you, O Lord our God, King of the universe,
who chooses us and makes us holy by the gift of the commandments.
Praise to you, O Lord our God, King of the universe,
who calls us together to worship and sends us out to witness and serve.
Praise to you, O Lord our God, King of the universe,
who revealed grace, love, and mercy in the offering of the Son, that we may know peace now and unending joy in the age to come.
Praise to you, O Lord our God, King of the universe.
Now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Of our swords, hear us when we cry to you. Lord, have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. Hear us when we cry to you. Christ, make us grow in grace until we see your face. Until we see your face, hear us when we cry to you. Lord, have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy. Defend your church, O Lord, and root it in your word, and root it in your word. Hear us when we cry to you. Lord, have mercy.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. Our royal and majestic Lord, God of gods, King of kings, there is no name more holy than your name, no power greater than your power. With praise and adoration, we bow humbly before you, offering ourselves and our resources to your service, seeking your favor now and when you come fully into your kingdom. We ask this of the Father, through the authority of your name, and in the love of the Spirit. Amen.
Our first lesson is from Enoch 53. The prophet Enoch recounts his vision. There my eyes saw a deep valley with open mouths, and all who dwell on the earth and sea and islands will bring to him gifts and presents and tokens of homage. But that deep valley shall not become full, and their hands commit lawless deeds, and the sinners devour all whom they lawlessly oppress. Yet the sinners shall be destroyed before the face of the Lord of spirits, and they shall be banished off from the face of his earth, and they shall perish forever and ever. For I saw all the angels of punishment abiding there and preparing the instruments of Satan. And I asked the angel of peace who was sent with me, for whom are they preparing these instruments? And he said unto me, they prepare these for the kings and the mighties of this earth, that they may be thereby be destroyed. And after this, the righteousness and elect one shall cause the house of his congregation to appear. Henceforth, they shall be no more hindered in the name of the Lord of spirits. And these mountains shall not stand as the earth before his righteousness. But the hills shall be as a fountain of water and the righteous shall have rest from the oppression of sinners. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Oh, sing of God's great victory, Jesus' blood has set us free. Let all God's creatures join our songs, for to Christ the throne belongs. Sing we alleluia, praise to the Lord, alleluia, alleluia. This is the feast of victory of the glorious Lamb above. Now all God's people gather round for the banquet of His love. Alleluia, praise to the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Oh, is it not a mystery that our Lord a Lamb should be? For on the cruel cross was slain, but arose in heaven to reign. Sing we alleluia, praise to the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. All honor, blessing, glory, might, sing His host to Christ on high. All power, riches, wisdom, strength, now to all His folk reply. Sing alleluia, praise to the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Our second reading is from 2 Thessalonians 3. Finally, brothers and sisters, pray for us so that the word of the Lord will spread rapidly and will be glorified everywhere, just as it is among you, and that we may be rescued from the wicked and evil people, for not all have faith, but the Lord is faithful, and He will strengthen you and guard you from the evil one. And we have confidence in the Lord concerning you, that you are doing and will go on doing the things we commanded. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of the Lord according to Matthew, the 12th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the crowd brought to Jesus a demoniac who was blind and mute, and he cured him, so that the one who had been mute could speak and see. All the crowds were astounded and saying, "This is not the son of David, is he?" When the Pharisees heard it, they said, "It is only by Beelzebub, the ruler of the demons, that this fellow casts out the demons." He knew what they were thinking and said to them, "All kingdoms divided against themselves are laid waste, and all cities or houses divided against themselves will not stand. And if Satan throws out, he is divided against himself. How then shall his kingdom stand? And if I, in Beelzebub, throw out the demons, by whom do your sons throw them out? Through this, they will be your judges. But if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come near to you. Or how is someone empowered to go into the strong man's house and have stolen his vessel, unless he has first bound up the strong man, and then his house will be ransacked? Whoever is not with me is against me. Whoever does not gather with me scatters." The Holy Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
So, what's up with all this demon stuff? I thought Halloween was last month. Well, is this the Nightmare Before Christmas? You know, for the solemnity of Christ the King, I was and still am very excited to preach for you today. And when I first was kindly allowed to preach for you for today's feast, I was thinking to myself, what readings might I preach from? Might it be Jesus riding in on his donkey into Jerusalem, the crowds with their palm branches crying, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Might it be a reading from my favorite gospel, the Gospel of John, not just because it has my name on it, where Jesus declares to Pilate that his kingdom is not of this world. Or might it be a scripture about Jesus as our anointed one, our Mashiach? "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good tidings to the poor." All of that would have preached so well. But no, we are confronted with Jesus the Exorcist. What on earth does Jesus the Exorcist have to do with Jesus, our beloved King? And yet, if we listen attentively to what the crowd is saying, it is the crowd themselves which draw a link between Jesus the Exorcist and Jesus the Mashiach, the anointed ruler. Because it is by casting out a demoniac spirit, making him blind, mute, that they say, "Could this be the son of David?" Why do they make this connection? And how on earth are we to understand this kingship business? After all, we Americans, a couple hundred years ago, did that Revolutionary War thing. So I invite us today to go on a historical journey, to examine these scriptures, not through 21st century American eyes, but through ancient eyes of kingship. But first, I want to begin with my own inauguration into kings and queens. You know, when I was 6 years old, before I lost my eyesight, my parents graciously and patiently brought me to the New York Renaissance Fair every single year. And there, of course, I would go in my plastic armor, and I would imagine that I was slaying mythical beasts like dragons and minotaurs and all that kind of stuff. As you could see, I still go to the New York Renaissance Fair every single year. And as you can absolutely see, I have upgraded the armor ever so slightly from plastic to metal. And as you could tell by my girth, I am still enjoying one too many turkey legs as well. Fortunately, with Thanksgiving recently, so have you, so I'm in good company. But what was curious about my adventure there as a child is I remember the very first time when I was leaving the fair, there was a large boulder, a rock protruding from the sunlit earth. And glistening in that rock was a magical sword. The sword in the stone. Now, I had seen a few animated films, I had gotten the general gist, but I still climbed upon that rock as a six-year-old boy, and I still squeezed the hilt of that sword, trying to yank it from the earth. And of course, my very gracious parents said, "John, it's a prop." But I still kept on trying. I still kept on trying to draw that sword from the stone. And although I walked away, unsuccessful, of course, although I still try every year. What was unique was I wasn't disappointed in my heart. In fact, there was a kind of gleam in my eyes because I saw an inner king in myself. You know, the story of Arthur gives us a good illustration of what biblical kind of kingship should look like. After all, it is a religious story that was composed by monks for at least the last 1,000 years or more. And what is unique about this story is, if you remember, the kingdom of Britannia is divided, ruler against ruler, kingdom against kingdom, petty thief against petty thief, dark magician against dark magician. Remember that the Greek word diabolos, for demon, means to scatter or to divide. The land must turn to a shepherd boy, Arthur, to pull the sword from the stone to unite the land. This brings about three vocations of kingship. First, this Arthur must throw down the gauntlet and cast out the cosmic rebels. He must drive out the dark agents which divide. Second, he must bring order out of chaos, bring about a utopian-like kingdom called Camelot. And then he is a servant leader. He sits as first among equals at the round table, something that we struggle today with, balancing hierarchy with egalitarianism. Now, all of these virtues, all of these ideas, can be found in every world monarch that has gone back through time. I think of Alexander the Great, who tried to unite Greek and barbarian, or the Age of the Caesars, the so-called Pax Romana. And yet, this idea of trying to create a utopian world goes really back to the Garden of Eden, doesn't it? To that book of Genesis, where it is God who first brings order out of chaos. Let light be. And it is God who casts out the cosmic rebels who create Diabolos, Lucifer and his fallen angels. And ultimately, it is God who invites Adam and Eve into the garden as the first king and queen over all of creation, who also bring order out of chaos, cultivating the garden. And they too are called to be servant leaderships. They are called to be servants of all, stewards over God's good creation and earth, naming the animals. Yet we all know what happens, don't we? Adam, like Lucifer before him, instead of becoming a servant leader, says, "Non servium," I will not serve. And so we have battled ever since then with the chaos inside of us and the chaos that is in the world, the diabolos that threatens to overwhelm us inside of us and the diabolos that is in the world. But God did not abandon his covenant. We know through the old covenant, through the gift of King David and through Solomon, they warred against the powers of darkness. They tried to bring order out of chaos by giving us the gift of the temple. And they also warred against the agents of Diabolos, the Amalekites, the Amorites, all the ites you can't pronounce in Bible study. But this is where the link comes between the monarch and the Exorcist. You know, in extra biblical literature, like the Dead Sea Scrolls in 11Q11, in the Solomonic Testament, and in the writings of Flavius Josephus, David and Solomon don't just drive out enemy armies. They realize that these armies are agents of cosmic darkness, and they are responsible for leaving behind exorcisms. Did you know your Bible supposedly contains them? Psalm 91, he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High shall rest under the shadow of the Almighty. Psalm 27, the Lord is my light and my salvation. You've had exorcisms on your phone and in your pocket. You just haven't realized it. And the thing about it is there is even a legend for us Tolkien nerds that Solomon even had a dark ring of power, one ring to rule them all, by which he even controlled some of these demons. Now, they're all pseudepigrapha, but so is our first reading today, the book of Enoch, supposedly going back to the days of Noah before the flood. This idea that the kings of Israel were supposed to cast out the powers of darkness and bring the kingdom of Eden to earth. But like Adam and Eve, we all understand what kind of happened, don't we? The chaos within, the chaos without. David commits adultery with Bathsheba. Solomon turns to other gods. The temple is destroyed. And so the temptation for the people of God then, just as the temptation of the people of God now, can be found in this expectation that maybe the anointed of God, maybe the real Messiah, when he comes, will drive out more than simply spiritual powers that make us spiritually blind and spiritually mute. Maybe he would drive out the Romans, the crowd perhaps was thinking when Jesus was driving out demons. Perhaps he will drive Caesar into the sea. And don't we think the same thing? If only the right philosophy, if only the right party, if only the right Democrats, Republicans, whatever, took control, maybe the kingdom of God would come near. But no matter how righteous our rulers are, no matter what we think of ourselves, like Adam and Eve, like David, like Solomon, and I regret to say even like King Arthur, we will ultimately fail because of that chaos within us and that diabolos without of us. And ultimately, that is why Jesus, as the perfect king, went to the cross for you and me. That is why Jesus, as the perfect substitutionary lamb, offers his life in exchange for ours. Now, this performs the ultimate exorcism. I understand that we Lutherans are sometimes uncomfortable with the language of angels and demons, but did you know that in this very church, we have seen exorcism performed by Pastor Chris? Now, hold on with me here. Every time an infant is brought to the baptismal font that is at the center of this church, what does Pastor say? Do you reject Satan, the powers of evil, etc.? And the sponsors say we do with the help of God. You see, in the baptism that we have received, according to our Lutheran confessions, according to our Lutheran writings, according to the teaching of the church for 2,000 years, we ourselves have received not only freedom from the power of the evil one, we are ordained priests, prophets, kings and queens. The question is, will we, like Adam, like Eve, like David, like Solomon, say non serviam and imitate a path of thinking that we should be the measure of good and evil? Or like Jesus, will we pull aside the veil? Will we realize that our real enemies aren't flesh and blood, parties, movements? Will we realize that no greater love has any man or woman than for us to lay down our lives for our friends? May we never wane in that vocation. And that is why I will never stop trying to pull that sword from that stone, for it is the Word of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Together with the Apostles' Creed, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And you will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
It was Abraham Lincoln who quoted today's reading from the Gospel according to Matthew
when he said, "A house divided against itself cannot stand." As we offer today's prayers and petitions, let us come before Jesus, that we might be one united household of faith, filled with love, listening, and understanding, and brought to full maturity through He who is Jesus the Christ. After saying, "Jesus, our gracious King," we will respond, "Lord, hear our prayer." Almighty and eternal God, you have entered in to the great story of life. You, who could have been born in a palace, you who could have been attended by servants dressed in silk, chose to be born among the poorest of the poor, in a stable, in a manger, surrounded by animals. Help us in this time of great feasting, in this time of merriment, not to lose sight of the needs of our brothers and sisters. May our hearts be opened. May our hands be spread wide to invite all of goodwill to your table, and to seek and save all hearts floundering in the darkness of this time. Where there is poverty, help us to sow the riches of your love and abundance. Where there is hatred, help us to sow your love. Jesus, our gracious King.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty and eternal God, we live in a house divided, where often political and social points of view create schism and division even among the households of faith. We pray, Lord, that you would soften hearts of stone, that you would give us new hearts of flesh and breathe within us the gift of the Holy Spirit. We thank you for our leadership, for Elizabeth A. Eden, presiding bishop, for our good Bishop Eggensteiner, for our pastor Chris, for all of our excellent deacons, for all of our lay servants, that together we may cultivate a community of unity built upon the rock of faith. Jesus, our gracious King.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty and eternal God, you called us in Adam and Eve to be stewards over all of creation. You called us to name the living creatures and to tend to the garden of life. Now we live in a time engaged in violence, both foreign and domestic. Our hearts go out to Israel and Palestine, to Ukraine. Our hearts go to our own cities. Help us, O Lord, our God, to be stewards of shalom and not stewards of diabolos. Help us to be stewards of righteousness by grace through faith, recognizing that we ourselves are flawed and not to become conceited in our own eyes. Only then will we truly one heart and one people in faith. Jesus, our gracious King.
Hear our prayer.
Now, O gracious and almighty Lord, we bring before you those names in our bulletin, for those who are presently suffering, for those who are infirm in our community. Just as you healed the demoniacs before, the blind, the sick, and the lame, those torn apart by war and famine, even so, through your children, through your servants, you raise up a culture of inclusivity, life, and openness to hospitality. May their love and their cries for healing be heard by you, O God on high. But may we also answer the challenge to be servant leaders, servant kings and queens, coming swiftly to their aid. Jesus, our gracious King.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Last, but never least of all, we bring before the pulpit of Golgotha, we bring before the altar of the manger our tears, our toils, our dreams, and our own personal pains. Those intentions written on our hearts, which, if they could be so counted, would eclipse every star of the heavens. But though we walk seemingly at times in shadow, we know that with you, all things are possible. And we know that with you, we are not scattered but gathered into one Eucharistic bread, one heart of peace. Jesus, our gracious King.
Hear, Lord, hear our prayer.
It is into your hands, O Lord, that we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of our Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us offer a sign of God's peace. Peace be with you, Brother John.
Wednesday, but I talked to you about that.
Peace. Peace.
How many times have you done this?
Three.
No intro.
Yeah, because they're not singing.
Hey,
they're just.
Let's do What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Yeah. Okay.
Please stand for the offering. Offertory, I'm sorry. Thank you. Let us pray. Acknowledging the many blessings received by your design and your grace, we offer these gifts back to the mission and ministry of your church. May your response of thanks be pleasing in your sight, and may you direct our offering to the sustenance of the universe. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Nancy, would you mind getting a host? What's that? There are wafers, but we'll wait for just talk amongst yourselves for a moment. I can give you a topic. Roy, did you eat it when you came up and set up? Is that, didn't have breakfast? Yeah, it is tasty. A little peanut butter on it.
We could do Alice's restaurant. Listen to it three times on Thanksgiving. And we'll put some.
Never happened before. It's keeps things exciting. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and responsible that we should, at all times and in all places, offer thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus the Christ, who overcame death in the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the heavenly choirs and all the saints of every time and every place, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Long, long ago in Jerusalem, as the scriptures do record, Isaiah to the temple came to see the Holy Lord. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, his glory fills the whole wide earth, God of power and might. High on his throne sat the mighty Lord, and his robe flowed through the hall, and six winged angels flew above. Isaiah heard them call, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, his glory fills the whole wide earth, God of power and might. Oh, what a sight it was to see, and oh, what a sound to hear. The temple doorpost shook and quaked, and smoke was in the air. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, his glory fills the whole wide earth, God of power and might. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. We recall and we proclaim that it is in your great love that you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who came as the Messiah, reaching out to heal the sick and the suffering, preaching good news to the poor, and inviting all to your table through his sacrifice on the cross. In the night when our Lord was handed over, he took the bread, he gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying to them, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for my remembrance. And then after supper, he took the cup, And when he had given thanks, he gave it for them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for my remembrance." Proclaiming his death, resurrection, and ascension, we gather here at this table as a foretaste of his return and the fulfillment of the kingdom. And calling to your remembrance, Father, these saving acts and the promises that you have given through them, we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit of hope and fellowship upon us now. For we come with willing and eager hearts to the feast that you have prepared, proclaiming all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
Thank you.
Please stand. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We rejoice that you use the harvest of the field, the fruit of the vineyard, and the fellowship of the table to fulfill your promise of an abiding presence in our lives. As we leave this sacred time, lead us out to faithful lives that manifest that presence through all that we say and do. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.
Amen. Amen.
To love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Shalom. Peace.
Thank you.